Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, DwyerVIP.com. Remember, the opinion you should follow should be your own. Just consider this video to be a second opinion from a complete stranger online. Well, this NBC boxing venture that's going to kick off in March with Adrian Broner against John Molina and Robert the Ghost Guerrero against Keith Thurman keeps getting bigger and bigger. Understand, now you have one of the historical greats, Sugar Ray Leonard, who's actually going to be involved. He's going to be ringside. He's going to be talking about the fights. Now understand who Ray Leonard was. I should say is, because knowing Ray, who knows? Maybe he'll be ringside again like he was when Hector Camacho fought many years ago, and then decide that he wants to get in the ring after getting in an argument with Hector. But let's put it this way. Ray Leonard's very misunderstood, right? The folklore is that Ray Leonard was a pretty boy who relied on hand speed. The reality, and I would encourage you to look at his boxing record closely on BoxRec.com, is that Ray Leonard was a huge puncher. In other words, Ray Leonard got stoppages. Compare and contrast his KO ratio with that of today's fighters. Understand, too, Ray Leonard was not content being a welterweight. So some of his biggest fights took place in higher weight classes. Understand, when Ray Leonard came back to fight Marvin Hagler, that was for the middleweight championship. Right? Understand, Ray Leonard then fought at higher weights than that. So when you look at Ray Leonard's KO percentage, just understand that like Sugar Ray Robinson, Leonard could end fights early. Now let me just say a brief lament on the Floyd Mayweather-Manny Pacquiao possible fight. I believe it's going to happen. As I said in an earlier video, I believe Manny Pacquiao is the only person Floyd Mayweather fights this year. Right? You know what? This fight should have taken place at 130 or 135. Because let's face it, both guys have been taking the distance most of the time of late. Right? Think about it. In Manny Pacquiao's case, you actually have elite boxers who are still in the game who've gone the distance with Manny Pacquiao multiple times. Right? You realize that in four fights against Juan Manuel Marquez, Manny Pacquiao never stopped him. You realize that? You realize two fights against Timothy Bradley. First fight, Bradley has two sprained ankles. Second fight, Bradley has a calf injury, right? He's in against Manny Pacquiao, who used to be a big-time puncher at lighter weights, right? Wasn't that Manny Pacquiao destroying David Diaz in his brief visit at 135 pounds? Wasn't that Manny Pacquiao stopping Oscar De La Hoya when he moved up in weight? But yet, even with a bad calf, Bradley was able to go the distance the second time. Keep in mind, too, guys like Brandon Rios, he was a guest star at 147. Right? Brandon Rios, really, if you look at his record, he made his name at lighter weights. But yet, Brandon Rios was able to go the distance against Manny Pacquiao. Right? Chris Algieri, for all the times he hit the canvas, went the distance against Manny Pacquiao. Now, Floyd Mayweather, I'll just say this. Unless there's a break in the action and the fighter is looking at Joe Cortez, the referee, during the break, and then Cortez says, box, Floyd Mayweather hasn't gotten an early stoppage. Right? It's the Victor Ortiz fight. That's the early stoppage. All the other fights, you're looking at your watch, right? It's like, okay, this is the fourth round. I know this is going to go another eight rounds. Right? Even when Mayweather's dominating, you're looking at him against Canelo. You're saying, wow, you know, Mayweather's faster than Canelo. Right? Wow, Canelo is losing round after round. Guess what? Canelo goes the distance. Doesn't look like he barely made it the distance. Right? Just understand that Ray Leonard was a different kind of fighter. Right? Ray was a KO threat. He fought a light heavyweight champion, Donnie Lalonde. Ray ended that fight early. I know there was a catch weight involved, right? I understand that. But even the catch weight was something like 168 or something, right? So just understand, as you see Ray Leonard ringside, this is boxing royalty. I know Ray hasn't been in the ring for years, right? But just understand, Ray Leonard knows about punching power. I'm sure Ray has very strong opinions. He used to do a hell of a job way back in the day, I think on HBO. I remember him being ringside for an early Hector Camacho fight when Hector Camacho won the title. I think we have a tendency to overlook the great fighters who came up in the past. Let me also talk briefly about this boxing venture. You know, it's revolutionary. Understand, the network didn't pay for the right to show these fights. According to reports, Al Haymon bought the time on the network. Right? This is revolutionary. This might change not only boxing, this might change sports in general. Just imagine the NFL network saying, you know what? Don't pay us any money. CBS, don't pay us any money. ESPN, we'll pay you for the time, and then we'll keep all the profits. The profits could be huge. What I want people to do is to pay close attention to the purses of the fighters, because keep in mind, these purses are public record. You have boxing commissions. And the boxing commissions will tell you how much what guy made. I get the feeling this venture is going to increase the purses, not only for the fighters in the venture, but for the fighters outside of the venture. Because keep in mind, if the take-home pay for a fighter fighting on NBC is X, then you're going to have a superstar who isn't fighting on NBC, who's going to say, hey, wait a moment, I'm the champ. I'm wearing the title belt. This contender made X on NBC. I'm demanding 2X for my fights. Right? What we're going to find out, too, is just how big the profits are for the networks and for promoters when boxing is financed a traditional way, right? I believe what you're going to find out is that the fighters under this new system with NBC are going to make far more money, right? Let me close, trying to add value here on a video, by talking about a huge fight that's coming up. It's big, and I believe my view is different from the public. It's Danny Garcia against Lamont Peterson. Now, both men fought Amir Khan. I believe the public was more entranced by Danny Garcia's destruction of Amir Khan, right? That fight ends by KO. Unfortunately for Amir Khan, the referee that night was wearing a mic and had a camera on him, right? So you saw how Khan looked like he had been in a car crash, right? Danny Garcia took him out, and it was impressive because Khan started that fight quickly. But understand, I'm on the other side of the fence. I actually prefer the destruction of Amir Khan. In fact, not the destruction, it's more of a deconstruction of Amir Khan by Lamont Peterson. Now, I'll agree, the scoring in that fight's a little bit hazy. The referee in that fight, you know, you have different points of view about his conduct that night, right? I'll agree that fight is close. I'll agree, too, Khan left that fight on the table. Could have won the fight. But understand, when you see a fighter who can beat you in slow motion, when you notice that Lamont Peterson, after a rough start, Khan, who's quick out of the gate, he reminds me of the sprinter Ben Johnson back in the day, right? Khan starts fast in that Lamont Peterson fight. But then what you notice is Peterson is able to dampen significantly Amir Khan's hand speed. He's able to back Khan into a corner. You start to realize that Peterson is really a boxing savant, right? He can, against a guy with lightning fast hand speed, he's able to take away that speed without running. He's able to be on his front foot without getting hit, right? He's able to methodically outbox guys. He's able to box you into a corner. Now, the problem with Peterson is that he had a car crash fight, right? People remember him getting blown out by Lucas Matisse. Fair enough. It happens, right? I'm going with Lamont Peterson in this bout against Danny Garcia. If a boxing match breaks out, I think Lamont Peterson easily outboxes Danny Garcia, who, in my opinion, is a mid-range hooker. I thought El Terrible, Eric Morales, had stretches of their first fight where he was outboxing Danny Garcia. Right? Now, Garcia, this is boxing. Right? Just like when you're playing cards and some guy has an ace, you could outwork him, but if he has the ace, he can throw it on the table and you're out of luck. Right? In boxing, punching power trumps boxing ability in some fights. Right? You know, Danny Garcia was having a problem with El Terrible. Then he started hitting El Terrible harder than El Terrible was hitting him. Right? The second fight, all you remember is the devastating KO. Danny Garcia is a puncher, no question about it. I've been a skeptic of Danny Garcia for some time. People here online might recall that, I thought Mauricio Herrera was going to outbox him and that Garcia would get the victory for political reasons since the fight was in Puerto Rico, and that's what happened. I even thought Rod Salka, in fact, I still maintain that Rod Salka had an opportunity against Danny Garcia. He foolishly gave it away by trying to, turn what could have been a masterful boxing match into a punch fest, and Salka almost got decapitated. Right? Here, I think Lamont Peterson, if he doesn't get caught, like he got caught early against Amir Khan, got off the canvas, was able to win that fight, and like he got caught by Lucas Matisse, right? If Lamont Peterson doesn't get caught, I think he outboxes Danny Garcia. I think Danny Garcia's only chance of winning this fight is a puncher's chance. I like Lamont Peterson against Danny Garcia, and I understand Garcia's unbeaten. I'll take my chances. I like Lamont Peterson against Danny Garcia, but I'm going to hedge the play with Garcia by KO. Why? Because I've seen Garcia put Lucas Matisse on the canvas. I've seen him put Eric Morales on the canvas. I've seen him put Amir Khan on the canvas. I've seen him put Rod Salka on the canvas. I'm noticing a bit of a trend. But as I like to say, in talking about Danny Garcia, I want people to go back to the Ashley Theopane fight. You're going to see a smaller man, in my opinion, right in front of Danny Garcia, outboxing him. When you realize that Garcia is a guy who, relies heavily on hooks, when you realize that his gimmick is to look away, so if you're looking at his eyes, you're like, what's he doing? He looks away while he's throwing a punch, right? So I've seen more than one guy in front of him looking at him saying, what's homeboy doing? Then they get hit and taken out, right? If you figure out that deceptive part of his game, and if you're able to just move your feet to make sure you're not mid-range on him, right? If you realize that his name's a bit bogus, right? Danny Swift Garcia. You know what? I'll buy the word Swift if we're talking about Gary Russell. I'll buy the word Swift if we're talking about Amir Khan. I'll buy the word Swift if we're talking about Manny Pacquiao's hand speed. Swift doesn't belong in the same sentence with Danny Garcia. If you get through the marketing and if you don't get caught up in the pre-fight hype with Danny's father, I think what you're going to find is a mid-range hooker who, for an elite fighter like Lamont Peterson, right? Peterson can just say, okay, I'm not going to be mid-range. I'm going to be out here long range, right? Danny can't reach me here. I'm going to be up close on Danny. Danny's not that great inside, right? If I'm mid-range, I'm going to know the punch isn't coming straight at me. The punch is coming with a hook. So if I find myself mid-range, I'm going to have a hand up here, right? I'm going to make sure that if he throws a hook, I have it blocked, right? I like Lamont Peterson. I think this is a great opportunity for him. I'll hedge the play with Danny Garcia by KO. I'm expecting the odds to favor Garcia. If they do, more beer for us. You'll get a better than even money rate of return, probably on both sides of the hedge. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Let me just say this too. It's a shame that Ray Leonard can't turn back the clock. Right, take us back to Ray Leonard right around when he fights Thomas Hearns the first time. Right, let's just say I believe that Ray Leonard would make quick work of Danny Garcia. In fact, if we turn back the clock, I believe the Hawk, a man who ruled the roost at 140, a man who beat Thomas Hearns in the amateurs, I believe Aaron Pryor would make quick work of Danny Garcia. Right, today, Danny Garcia, and I'll give him credit, he's fought tough opponents, right? Lucas Matisse, Amir Khan, he's been there, he's done that, hasn't he? Right? El Terrible? But these days, Danny Garcia is an unbeaten champion. My, how times have changed. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Thanks for stopping by. By the way, of course, I take Alexis Arguello over Danny Garcia. Thanks for stopping by.